Hello and welcome to the show. In this episode, I'm going to take you through the progress I've made on the dual Pi laptop. That's a Raspberry Pi 2 and a Banana Pi laptop. And I'll take a quick look at the Raspberry Pi 3 and compare that to the Raspberry Pi 2, the main differences. Okay, so for this particular build, I've used A4 sized pieces of 3mm smoke grey acrylic as the main structure to the case. This works reasonably well as long as there's enough support between the bridges. As you can see here, there's a small bow between the two endpoints. And that's easily remedied by putting another piece of support material and a bridge in between those two endpoints. The acrylic makes making a structure nice and easy and simple, but there are a few things to consider. In my case, the pieces that arrived were not perfectly square. This complicated the build process quite a lot. I had to accommodate for the variances in the sizes in the square of the pieces inside of the plastic corner pieces that I printed. Also, I don't know whether or not this particular batch of acrylic was particularly brittle, but it was definitely less tolerant to cutting and drilling than other pieces of acrylic I've used. I had to print a 1mm piece of plastic, use that as a bit of a nameplate in order to be able to cover up and repair some broken acrylic. The plastic corners for the laptop are 3D printed, but making them out of wood wouldn't be too difficult. The hinges are also printed, as are the supports for the IPS display. The display is mounted on a single piece of acrylic with a couple of small 3D printed guides holding that in place. The guides are attached to the acrylic using hot glue. Hot glue and acrylic work really, really well together. If you make a mistake, you can actually remove the hot glue from the acrylic without any damage whatsoever. Okay, the display itself, the display is superb, absolutely brilliant, probably the best I've ever purchased. It is razor sharp, it has great colors and a superb viewing angle. It's quite thin, only about 3mm thick, has a standard IPS 40-pin connector on the back, taking the wires through to the driver board. And the driver board will be quite familiar for those that have used these kinds of devices before. The driver board has the standard HDMI, VGA and composite inputs in order to be able to display things on the screen. And in my case, I've got the Raspberry Pi 2 connected to the driver board via a small HDMI cable. Okay, so the internals of the laptop aren't too dissimilar to things I've done in the past. We have the Raspberry Pi 2, we have a Banana Pi 1, I have the driver board for the display itself. There's a Sparkfun lithium polymer battery charger, that's the 12711 I've used previously. I've got a 5-volt power regulator, a Pololu branded one, that's driving the Raspberry Pi and the screen. I have a separate power regulator, another 5-volt one, less current going through that one, but that is powering the Banana Pi by itself. And both of those power regulators are individually switched and have access to the battery bank. I also have the battery that I took out of the DoShin power bank and the little display board that went with that in order to be able to give you the battery remaining. That particular one doesn't work all of that well. Those batteries are low in capacity and they take up quite a bit of space in this project, and the display is not producing a very accurate reading of the remaining battery. Also inside the laptop, as you can see, there is an Ethernet cable. This is a crossover cable. This connects the Banana Pi's 2 Ethernet port to the Raspberry Pi 2 Ethernet port. And this is useful because you can actually get the Banana Pi to be doing video decoding, or you can get it to do torrent downloads or some other sort of server functions independently of the Raspberry Pi, and the Raspberry Pi can access those facilities over Ethernet, including the actual internet connection itself. So the Raspberry Pi's desktop is freed up to deliver the most available desktop experience that it can with the CPU and the RAM that's available in the Raspberry Pi 2. The Banana Pi isn't connected up to the display board at all. You access the Banana Pi over the Ethernet or the Wi-Fi connections using VNC and using Webmin interface. So things I'll do differently with this project, and there's a few. Firstly, the battery bank. Those batteries are low capacity batteries and they take up quite a bit of space inside the project. About 6 amp hours of battery capacity with that particular battery bank. If I get rid of those and just put in 3 or 4 18650s at a higher capacity, I can have up to 10 hours of battery life and less space taken up in the project. Additionally, the little display that tells you how much voltage you've got left, or the battery gauge itself as a percentage, I'd get rid of that and I'd put in a simple voltmeter to tell me the voltage remaining of the battery bank, or even an Arduino, a MicroView Arduino, in order to be able to accurately give me some battery information. Another thing I didn't particularly like, although I used it a couple of times in different projects, is the keyboard. This keyboard's great as a media center type keyboard or a small little device type keyboard, but as an actual laptop or something that you want to use for more than a few minutes at a time, it's not very good at all. I'd have to replace that with something more along the lines of this particular keyboard, or maybe this one over here that should fit into the same footprint as this laptop. And now that the Raspberry Pi 3 has come out, obviously exactly the same footprint as the Raspberry Pi 2, which is great. I would swap out the Raspberry Pi 2 and pop in that Raspberry Pi 3. And this particular project's still missing audio. I've got the audio driver, the amplifier, and I've got a couple of speakers ready to go in, but they haven't been installed just yet. I might actually do a small separate video on those. The performance of the Pi 2 is quite reasonable for everyday use. Even in the unoverclocked configuration, it will open up IceWeasel and play YouTube videos in standard resolution. If video is your thing, you can quite easily install Kodi inside of Raspbian, fire up the Kodi Media Center and include the YouTube add-on, and you can watch YouTube videos and all sorts of other media content using Kodi on the Raspberry Pi inside the laptop. So how does the Pi 3 compare to the Pi 2? Well, as I've already mentioned, the footprint's exactly the same. They've just moved a few LEDs, and obviously this one includes Wi-Fi and Bluetooth 4. One of the main differences is the CPU. Instead of having a 32-bit ARM A7 CPU, we have a 64-bit ARM A52 CPU. Instead of the 900 megahertz quad core of the original Raspberry Pi 2, we're now talking a 1.2 gigahertz quad core CPU. And the addition of Bluetooth on the Raspberry Pi 3 makes it easier than ever before to connect to Bluetooth-enabled peripherals and to free up the USB ports that you would normally take up with either a Bluetooth adapter or a Wi-Fi adapter. So in wrapping up, I think this project came out okay. I am going to revisit it, or at least I think I'll revisit it. I can make the laptop thinner. There's a few wasted areas of space in there, and it doesn't need to be as thick as it actually came out. I would embed the Raspberry Pi 3 pretty much straight away, may even change out the Banana Pi for the Raspberry Pi 2, so have a Raspberry Pi 2 and 3 laptop running in there, and of course finish off the audio component so it could play audio nicely through the laptop. So how would you have approached this project? What else would you have included? What would you have left out, if anything at all? By all means, let me know in the comments of this video, and that's it for now. So thanks very much for joining me and watching the show. If you liked it, please give it a thumbs up. That really helps a lot. Subscribe, of course. Leave comments in the comments section of this video. I'll always look at those. And I hope you'll join me again in a week's time.